Good evening, everybody. I'd like to welcome you to the March 6, 2017 Reading School Committee meeting. We're being taped live tonight by RCTV, so thank you to them. We are going to start, as we always do, with a call for public comment, if anyone from the public would like to address the committee. Seeing no public comment this evening, we're going to move on to our consent agenda.
Is there anyone that would like anything taken from the consent agenda? I'll move to present the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
All those in favor? 6-0. The consent agenda passes. Reports, no students tonight, huh?
No.
Taking a night off. Good for them. Liaison reports. Anyone on the committee have a liaison report? No? Dr. Doxer?
I was just looking for my notes.
Chuck, did you get to class last week?
I was privileged to go to the school musical this weekend, 1776. And I thought that it was a great example of how the extracurricular activities go beyond just entertainment, just beyond just activities for kids after school, beyond. Aside from the costumes and the involvement of the kids in all aspects of the production, I wanted to point out the choices of what the productions are as well, and that this production was 1776. And actually, I think the director said what I'm thinking a lot better than me, and I would like the liberty to read this paragraph from the program. So the director is an alumni of our theater group, of our school, Caitlin Beckman, which in and of itself is a really inspiring thing, to have the students be so connected to the program and so motivated and inspired by the process that they want to come back and lead other students and be role models is really something. And then to do it as well as was done for this production. So Caitlin wrote, this year, the RMHS Drama Club season is united by the common theme of perseverance. In each of the performances this year, you have seen or will see characters who are steadfast in achieving success despite the challenges they must face. In 1776, we see a determined John Adams faced with an arduous task. In a moment when the challenges seem too anchored in place to ever contend, Abigail reminds John what he once told her: there are only two creatures of value on the face of the earth, those with a commitment and those who require the commitment of others. The support and commitment of those who stood by Adams enabled our forefathers to design and establish our country, grounded in equality and the unalienable rights, definitely attainable, rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Seeing the rights of our founding fathers fought so vigorously to obtain reminds us that these rights should not be taken for granted nor diminished in any way. Our country has again approached a monumental time of political unrest, and perseverance is on the minds of all. We can take a page from the history books and pledge to constructively debate with open minds and hearts, to stand up for our own rights and the rights of others, and to work together with a commitment to persevere. Just like the members of Congress on stage, we band together as the people of our United States of America to protect the foundation on which we were built. And I just thought that that was so well stated in the production, such a quality, high quality production. It just bears mentioning that there's so much more to these extracurricular activities.
I will add to that. I was also there, and I was sitting with a row of about 7 fifth graders, and they loved it from beginning to end. I mean, it was a phenomenal production, so I agree with you completely. Go ahead.
CPAC. This coming, the 11th, March 11th, is a meeting with Laura Gem here in the superintendent's conference room, where people will be trained for open meeting law, and it's the board is going to be here of the Special Education Parents Advisory Committee, but everybody and anybody is welcome. It's really eye-opening to know what rules we operate under, and so it would be helpful, I think, whoever is interested to come to this training. And then I wanted to do a very brief report on the Human Relations Advisory Committee. We had Jason Lewis, Senator Jason Lewis, come to our meeting on Thursday night. And we had a full house. We had selectmen. We had the two commissioners from the Human Rights Commission of Wakefield. We had inspiring students from our schools. We had townspeople. We had the Human Relations Advisory Committee with us. And the topic that we ended up speaking the most about was the structure for our Human Relations Advisory Committee going forward. We are due to be sunset in June of this year, and so we're working really hard. We have a subcommittee working with the selectmen to try to come up with a structure that works. Wakefield has been unbelievably supportive and informative in this process, as they were at this meeting. We were able to have a presentation by our students of a survey they did at our high school. They were very grateful for the support and help of our principal, Adam Bacher. And I know we're not going in depth today, so just want to make sure. So the survey that they presented was about discrimination and hate in the town of Reading. They reported on what they had found out. And I have talked to to the superintendent and the school committee chair about other things that came out of that meeting. Mm-hmm. Sorry, I'm looking at the minutes to make sure that I cover everything. Okay, so we basically had a very animated discussion of what the structure could and should be. And then we went into our upcoming events. So our liaisons from the World of Difference program are actively looking for other students that might want to be on our committee. They have had a real learning experience on our committee that I hope that they will take forward and change the world with. I feel very confident that they will. They are planning a library event on March 29th from 2 to 3:30, ages grades kindergarten through fifth grade. It's a special story time with themes of diversity. So it's a half day. Please bring your children. It will be really remarkable. These are incredible role models, so much so that we got a call from the Senator Jason Lewis after the meeting asking for the contact information of our students, because another town wants to emulate the survey that they were able to do in our schools. And I got their permission first. But they were interested in helping other schools, which is huge because they're so busy. June 17th is Friends and Family Day. Come look for the Human Relations Advisory Committee. And METCO Lobby Day is March 14th. And there are at least four of us now going from here, some going from Boston. We're going to rendezvous there. We have appointments set up with our legislators. So if you're interested in joining us, please email me. I do have room in my car. And I guess that's a real quick summary of a very exciting meeting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anything else from the committee?
Dr. Darty,
are you talking about court?
Yeah, but you can if you want. That's fine.
No.
Okay. As long as someone's got it.
Yeah.
All right. Dr. Doherty.
Mrs. Dowd has one short item.
I just wanted to let everyone know we have included in your packet this evening some answers we did have a town meeting member who asked us a series of questions, and she asked that as they were available, if we could provide the answers to her. So what's included in the package is the answer to a subsection of her questions. We just wanted to make sure everybody had them, and we are continuing to maintain the question and answer document that we have pulled together. So all of these will be included in that document as well.
So when the school committee budget goes to town meeting, all of these additional questions will be added to school committee questions, FinCom questions, and other public questions. Thank you for including this, Ms. Dowd. I know the amount, it's hard to articulate the amount of work you've done on this, because the details are lengthy. The questions are lengthy, so all I can say is thank you, but thank you.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have a few items. I think they're all good. I do want to echo what Ms. Borowski and Mrs. Doxa said about, Dr. Doxa said about 1776, and commend the job that Caitlin Beckman did directing the show and Chris Killian did with the musical piece. It's always great to see. I've known Caitlin for a long, long time through as a student here, through Five Star, as a counselor, and now as a guest director for the drama club. And it's just a tribute to the amount of impact that Bill Enslow has had on this program, because Natalie Cuna was a graduate of the program, Caitlin Beckman was a graduate of the program. I know Lindsay McGovern, who was involved with the dance choreography piece, is a graduate of the program. So a lot of talent has come out of this drama program, and it started with Bill and Kristen and others. So again, just kudos to that, to the production. It was a great job. We have a middle school production coming up this weekend, Parker Middle School, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and yeah, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. They are doing Once Upon an Island Junior. So that starts on Thursday night, Friday, and Saturday. So the middle school productions are always great as well. And the kids always have a great time doing it. So if you have an opportunity to see that. Tuesday night, tomorrow night, the Ring Memorial High School is gonna be the host to the Massachusetts Association of Jazz Educators Jazz Festival. Two of our jazz bands will be performing at it, our stage band and our jazz band. I'm not sure the exact times, but that starts at 2 o'clock and then goes until about 9:30 when they have the awards. I do want to highlight that the Coolidge Science Olympiad team won the state Science Olympiad championship this past weekend. They competed against 29 other middle school teams at Assumption College in the Massachusetts State Science Olympiad. Out of the 22 events, they placed in 20 of the 22, top six, and they won 11 first place finishes. So they did a remarkable job, and now they have the honor of going to the National Science Olympiad competition, where they will join teams from other states. Some teams get to send one team, some states get to send one team, some states get to send two teams, depending on the size of the state. So Coolidge will be representing Massachusetts. The National Science Olympiad will be at Wright State University in Dayton, Ohio, and that'll be in mid-May. So I want to congratulate Coach Karawan Mead and all of the parents and other coaches that and the students that have been involved in this. I believe that is the 23rd year that Coolidge has won the state championship. I may be off by 1 year, but it's either the 22nd or the 23rd year. So congratulations to them for all their hard work. I do want to give an update on Joshua Eaton, the principal search. The applications continue to come in. We're at 29 applications right now. The deadline is March 10th. And today we had the meeting of the screening committee. The screening committee was published in the newsletter this week. Carolyn is on the screening committee. Joanne King, Rochelle Shanklin, those are the administrators. The teachers include Kathleen and Jemmy, Allison Burns and Jamie Quinn. Amy Greco is the staff member, she's the secretary, she's on the screening committee. And three parents, Amy Branson, Julie Ross, and Christine Lusk. So they had their initial meeting today, talked about the logistics, the rules, all of that. They are starting to develop the questions. They will finalize the questions next week at their meeting, and then we will be doing interviews at the end of next week. And the timeline still is on schedule. The goal is to have an announcement of a principal selection the week of April 10th. So I think that is it. Thank you.
Can I just add one quick thing? So I know we're all incredibly proud of the Coolidge Science team, so I just want to mention that it takes a lot to get that team to Ohio and for people to mark their calendars, because early May, one of the most important events that the Coolidge Science team has to help it get to nationals is the yard sale. And that's a two-way street, so if you haven't already started saving your stuff for the yard sale, start now and then look forward to May. So we really want to see that team get there.
I did have one more thing. Next Monday night, March 13th, 7 o'clock here at the Performing Arts Center. The Understanding Disabilities, our CASA and the Reading Public Schools are sponsoring a 2-hour presentation called Just Talk About It. It's mental health for teens. And we're inviting high school students and adults to attend. It's 2-hour presentations for parents, high school students, teachers, and adults to learn the warning signs of mental health issues in adolescents and teens. It's going to be a 2-part presentation. The first part is an interactive presentation to increase your awareness of what is considered a crisis, how stress affects a teenager, the symptoms of depression, the warning signs most associated with suicide, and how to help a student or a friend. The second hour, Melissa Ann Hopley will share her personal experience with mental health challenges, bullying, and the help that saved her. And she's the author of the book, The People You Meet in Real Life. So it sounds like an absolutely fabulous program. And it's free. There's no charge. And it is here at 7 o'clock. Doors open at 6:45 at the Performing Arts.
It does sound like an excellent program and an important topic. All right, is that it for reports?
That's it.
All right, we have one agenda item today, but it's an important one. Mr. Bacher is here and Ms. Williams is here to talk to us a little bit about one of our district improvement plan goals, specifically closing the achievement gap. So I will turn it over to you, where I'm very excited.
I'm actually going to kick us off.
I'm going to ask you for some direction, because you know we're a chatty bunch and we have a lot of questions.
Yeah.
How would you like to structure questions? Can you maybe take breaks throughout?
Yep. I mean, this is a fairly brief presentation. Mostly I want to be able to give Mr. Bacher and Ms. Williams a chance to talk about how this is going to play out at the high school with the consolidation of levels. But I thought it'd be really important to sort of frame it and explain some of the reasons why this is really a very important discussion. So I might, there's sort of a gap between a few slides before I turn it over. If there's any questions there, maybe I could take some that's sort of big picture and then maybe save questions to the end about specifics or details. So, I mean, as you know, one of the focus areas in our district improvement plan is about closing the achievement gap. I really think first I want to sincerely commend our staff, our administrators, and our teachers for sort of the willingness to tackle this issue directly, because it really is a complicated issue. It's something that's talked about a lot in public education, and there's a lot of research and evidence about this topic. But I thought that's important. I mean, it's still a tough thing to tackle because it also has to do with some changes in status quo. And some challenges for those of us as educators, even when we know that it's in the best interest of kids, it can bring on some challenges, and that we're a district that's willing to embrace that, I think, is worthy of commendation. So specifically, we wanted to look at sort of this issue of student grouping and levels of courses and things and how that can play into the achievement gap or closing the achievement gap. So I thought I'd start with first just sort of a definition. I mean, I think people are aware of what we mean by the achievement gap, but I thought in case there's anybody there in the public who might be confused because it's such a common phrase that we hear, I thought I'd talk about it. So this is a quote from an article that appeared several years ago in EdWeek, in Education Week, the Education Journal. And basically, I mean, I won't read it for you, but basically it explains there that the achievement gap refers to the disparity in academic performance between groups, or subgroups as they're often called today, of students. And that achievement gap can show up in various areas, grades, the standardized test scores, the state assessment scores, but also things like course selection, the enrollment of different groups of students within different types of classes, dropout rates, and any other sort of success measures that we would use. As it explains there, most often probably across the country in many communities, it's used most to talk about any disparity when it comes to race, ethnicity, and even income groups, especially how low income children from low income families are able to access curriculum and achieve. But as it says there at the end, certainly in the last several years across many states, and certainly Massachusetts is one, it's also increased to look at other areas besides race, ethnicity, income, to include areas like gender, how achievement or enrollment in things breaks down by gender, or by English language learners, or with learning disabilities, which, as you know, in our district, especially with many in-district programs, that's something that we're looking at very closely. I thought it's also worth a mention as well, as even though I think people are aware of this, how this gap is also sort of worked into the how Massachusetts focuses or has aligned their accountability measures, their accountability ratings. So clearly, one of the things that Massachusetts is measuring for all districts is how each district is ensuring that all of their students are eventually, over a matter of years, reaching proficiency, including how the various subgroups are achieving that potential. So as it says there, Massachusetts classifies schools on a 5-level scale. All those that are meeting their gap narrowing goals are level 1, and the lowest performing are level 5. I think most people are aware of that. Currently, 80% of schools, I believe it is, are classified into level 1 or 2 based on this cumulative progress and performance index, as the state calls it, for the all students and high needs groups. As it says there too, we've talked about this before when we've looked at the data around state assessments, that the state defines high needs as a student who is either economically disadvantaged, an English language learner, or a student with disabilities. And you've even heard Mr. Sprung talk about this, especially with some of the work that's happening there with it at Joshua Eaton and with their staff and families there, of how to address the issue with some of the disparity with the high needs group. Massachusetts also determines which districts have specific needs or technical assistance for intervention, especially in the area of special education. The next bullet there talks about the different categories, the meets requirements at risks, needs technical assistance. And again, you've heard Mr. Sprung talk about, because that's a rating that is associated with writing the NTA, or needs technical assistance, so that's a focus area for our district to look at how we're addressing that high needs group. And again, in that last bullet, I just wanted to stress that this designation puts a huge focus on students with disabilities to make sure that they are progressing in the same rate that we would want them to with the all student aggregate group. So just sort of big picture issues, I thought I just would point out a few topics, why this is sort of a very nuanced and complex issue. And I love this article from several years ago. Again, this is from Educational Leadership. And it talks about first needing to close the opportunity gap, because we really do think in many cases that the achievement gap can be exacerbated by not making sure that all students have access to the same opportunities and then the same ability to access the same level of expectations. And so as it says there, especially with the accountability system that began several years ago, it's more than several years ago, back with the No Child Left Behind law, they say, you know, with so many education policymakers so determined to raise standards and close achievement gaps, what is holding us back? Clearly, within each state, the assessments were standardized and so forth, but in all courses, the curriculum is necessarily not the same. As it says there, nothing ensures that all students have been taught the same content. In fact, given the prominent place of ability grouping and tracking in the accepted education paradigm, it is highly unlikely that all students have had an equal opportunity to master the subject matter required to pass these assessments. To achieve the goal of high-quality education for all, we must seriously examine the tracking and ability grouping paradigm that has defined our education system for so long. And of course, as it says here, we still need to address diverse learning styles, needs, interests of all of our students. However, we need to transform the system to guarantee that all students are given equal opportunities to develop their fullest potential. And I thought that was a great way of sort of framing this complicated sort of challenge, that first we have to close the opportunity gap. How are we making sure that all kids are having access to these opportunities? Another sort of complicated issue that comes about with this is the issue of equity. And so a couple quotes here, one's from Ed Leadership, again, from an earlier article. Much of the research and evidence around this goes back decades. And then here's a more recent book, also that first one there, Detracking for Excellence and Equity. There is little doubt that tracking does the most harm to students who are consigned to the lowest track. According to the National Research Council, low-track classes have an especially deleterious effect on learning. And from the article in Educational Leadership, ability grouping and tracking rarely add to overall achievement in a school, but they can often contribute to inequality. This finding is most consistent for high school tracking, but it is not uncommon in other forms and at other levels. Typically, it can mean that high-track students are gaining and low-track students are falling farther behind. You've heard us talk before about Dr. John Hattie's research and work. All of the administrative team over the last year or two have used some of his research and his writings. I'm a big fan of how he has essentially been a studier of the studies, you know, in his meta-analyses. And as I've, I didn't hit the slide, I'm trying to do both here. What he calls visible learning in his visible learning database, composed of more than 1,200 meta-analyses with more than 70,000 studies, has included approximately 300 million students. He's come to the conclusion that tracking has very close to a zero effect size on student achievement, but that it can present challenging issues in equity by not allowing all students to access high-level expectations. He pretty much frames things that most of what we do in education has some positive impact, even if it's minimal or close to zero. There's very little that we do that has a negative impact, but that we clearly, if we're going to be investing time, energy, resources, finances, whatever, to things, we want to make sure that they're things that are high leverage, that provide the most impact to students. He says here in one of his books, this one happens to be much focused more on mathematics, but that permanently tracking students can contribute to a destructive and fixed mindset. And that's been a big thing in the last several years, really focusing on the type of mindset that we create and how we group students and the type of learning environments that we create. Most importantly, he says, the students placed most at risk by the practice of permanently assigned ability groups are those that can least afford it. Students who struggle, are learning English as a subsequent language, or have disabilities. And I think it's really important there that he says permanently. So we're going to talk about a couple of things here. I'm using both these so I don't have to use my glasses for one thing and then also look at the slide. So some steps that we have been making in our system. So some of these we have been doing this year and there's some things we have planned as we're moving forward for the fall. First of all, over the last year or more, Just as some of those quotes have said, we have been examining our grouping and instructional practices very closely. The second bullet there, especially how students with high needs are being grouped for instruction. And are we ensuring that we are using best practices to facilitate their progress? How permanent or flexible are some of those groups? It's been communicated out with the high school and then with the middle school. Also, I believe a letter went out today that we are consolidating our levels in grade 7 math for next year and grades 9 through 12 English, science, and social studies, essentially eliminating the lowest level, moving from then from 3 levels to 2 levels. For that to be successful, there are several things also that we are stressing that we need to make sure is important. One is that we maintain existing standards and expectations in all the remaining levels, that we do not lower expectations in any of the remaining courses or levels. That's key. We've been having some great conversations with staff about that. We need to ensure that any grouping practices below grade 7 are flexible and not fixed for long periods. I believe actually Mr. Sprung even talked some about that in the earliest grades, how we're looking at that to make sure, because there's a lot of research that shows, you know, truly flexible grouping where kids can move in and out in small groups and things, but it's not fixed for long periods of time, where it really does sort of create this fixed mindset and sort of unintentionally can imply sort of a ceiling of expectations with that. So we're examining that closely as well. We are absolutely retaining courses that provide opportunities to challenge and or accelerate students who show readiness. You know, there's honors classes, the algebra in the middle level, and all of that sort of stuff. We do not intend in reducing those. We're hoping that we have more and more students that can access those. So we certainly don't want to go in that direction, but as some of the other quotes showed, we aren't concerned there. We think we are actually helping our overall results by providing those opportunities. But it's the lowest level, the lowest track that we do have some concerns about. Another thing that's key as we do this is to be sure that we provide effective supports and tier 2 interventions for students who may struggle. We will always, in any school system, have students that are struggling at various points. And we have to have ways to support them, provide interventions that's necessary. That doesn't, however, necessarily mean that we're resorting them into another course or another box or things, but we absolutely need to make sure that we're providing the supports and interventions for them. That's on the student side. And then, of course, on the staff side, we need to support teachers with professional development on topics like inclusive instructional practices, differentiated instruction, and so forth. We've been having conversations, some of that's already begun, and how we can continue to do that very effectively for staff. So that's sort of my overview of sort of why this is an important topic to look at, and I want to give Lena and Adam a chance to address exactly how this plays out, because the biggest impact is leave at the high school, but we could pause there for a moment if people had questions or clarification about just the issue.
I have one. Can you go ahead? Sorry. Can you work through what the middle school, the current, you said that you're collapsing in grade 7.
Yes.
Can you explain how it is now and how it will be in the future?
Yes.
Thanks.
So currently students are in heterogeneous math classes up through 6th grade. And then we have traditionally gone through a process. We sort of assess students' readiness because many of these things click at different times for students developmentally to determine which level of math they should go into in 7th and 8th grade, which sort of sets them up for various pathways before they go on to high school. So currently in the last few years there have been 3 options. So there's been the regular math 7, as we call it, okay, which is currently the lowest level. We have the Math 7 Enhanced, which is a slightly faster paced, which allows basic same curriculum, but allows students to go into a little bit more depth and application into that. And then we have in 7th grade what we are calling Math 7-8, which is a very accelerated and rigorous course, because it's essentially, it's called Math 7-8, because it's basically taking the 7th and 8th grade standards together and doing them in 1 year. Okay. Students then who are in that course, let me start for them from the high end, if they succeed in that class, they then move into Algebra 1 in 8th grade. So a couple things have happened. So we are taking away for next year the lowest level to make sure that all students have access to the high expectations that we're providing students in the enhanced group. That can also benefit students. If you remember too, we have the new pathways available to this year's 8th grade class, so that anyone who is exceeding in the enhanced course and gets recommended for honors algebra in ninth grade would have a direct 4-year path. We put a lot of focus on AP calculus, in the community, without doubling up, without taking a summer course, whatever. So essentially, all students would be in at least that level class. And we also have been making the point with the middle schools that the key foundation to retain success in math through high school is that really firm foundation by the fully aligned, rigorous Algebra 1 class. And now we're really pleased that we have two opportunities to do that, either in 8th grade or in 9th grade, without it adding any other wrinkles in a student's pathway. It can still be direct. That there really is very little, if any, advantage in a student. Matter of fact, I'd say it would be a disadvantage for a student to rush into it before they're ready, because it would tend to derail them later. So that whether it's an 8th or 9th grade. We've decided, I mentioned Math 7, because we decided that because we're able to, it would be best to, instead of changing 7th and 8th grade at the same time, since it's basically a 2-year sequence, we would begin with 7th grade next year and allow the current 7th grade for 8th grade to continue, because that way it would just be smoother, both for teachers and for students.
Thank you. And just to clarify, math is the only subject area
in middle school. Yes.
In middle school that has this ability tracking. Everything else is heterogeneous.
Exactly. Yes.
Mrs. Webb had one, and then Mr. Robinson.
And I really want to get to hear Mr. Bacher and Linda Williams, but so this can probably wait till the end. But I have some budget questions related to the resources that we need to provide with to support these programs in terms of the tier 2 supports and providing the support for teacher PD and inclusivity training. And so at the end when we're
okay.
Done
I'll just add real quickly, I mean, we've been having conversations at each level about, you know, how do we really streamline and pick focus areas, use some of the existing time. We've gotten some suggestions from staff about how best to do that, so that is an issue that we've been talking about, but you know, we can talk more about that at the end.
Mr. Robinson.
So I guess along those lines, I'm figuring that this is going to be put up. So this got a fair amount of discussion during our budget process, and I'm concerned that there's nobody here. I don't know why, whether they didn't know about it or whatever. But this is good. Can this get a separate link on the website, or versus being buried in our packet somewhere?
I always put the presentations on the main page under news, and it's always there for any presentation that we do. So this will be up tomorrow morning.
Along with that, because I was going to just try to like see where the presentations are. I think it's really important that the presentation that Trace Keehan did, which has the math pathways, is in close proximity to this presentation, because if somebody's
really
looking at this, they're going to want to look at that, just as Ms. Browski asked the question. So even if it means it's repeated in a second spot in our webpage, I would ask that be done.
That's a good point.
Yeah. So the January 4th math presentation put this close and side by side?
Yeah.
Yep.
Mr. Bovin.
Yeah, where, can you remind us again, going back to the earlier conversation, where we've already collapsed from 3 to 2 tracks across the district?
So there's a couple areas that it's already happened at high school, and I think you've got a slide that shows that coming
up.
So,
okay. And is this the first time that we've done this in the middle school?
Is it the first time that we've collapsed? I'm trying to remember. Well, there were times, I think, when we only had two levels.
We only had two.
I think then it expanded.
And when we added the algebra, we actually moved everything up, so.
So this will be the first time, and is there an achievement?
It's not the first time we've had two, but it's the first time we went from 3 to 2, if that makes sense. We've had two in the past, but yeah.
Separate question. Is there an achievement gap with these students that we're trying to close? Either in seventh grade or in, is that with the evidence of that gap?
Yeah. And one of the things we look at in all of these levels is, how are those students progressing over a matter of years? How many students in the various subgroups, for instance, how many students that have IEPs? What's the percentage of students in that class? Because what we certainly don't want to do is create unintentionally what would end up to be almost a sub-separate class with a very high percentage of students on IEPs that may not be getting the same sort of expectations, unless their IEP specifically calls for that, unless their IEP calls for a sub-separate class or a modified curriculum. And so we have been looking at that data as well, and we feel that overall it's more advantageous for kids to have the access to the class, but be sure that we're providing the supports necessary to help them make progress.
Can I ask, is it a different topic?
No.
Okay, good.
Yeah, same topic. Okay. The data that you look at, I just want to understand what we're looking at and what we're maybe not looking at. So you could think of different ways you could identify gaps in the first few slides that you had, right? So the most obvious is there's going to be state testing, and I'm assuming you're looking at least the populations. And what I have here that I was just kind of mapping onto this, I just want to think if my way of thinking about this is the way that we really are thinking about it, or if it's something different. So the populations you mentioned in the first few slides, if you look at, it's figure 25 in the school committee budget, but it's enrollment history for high needs populations.
Yeah.
So I just want to make sense that the way we're breaking down the budget is tracking the way we're doing this analysis here, and they could be compared, right? So you have, you know, couple columns that deal with it. I'm not going to get into the numbers, but just the categories that we have there to remind people so they don't have to flip to it. Just first language, not English, or limited language proficiency, category one, broadly speaking, two, income-based, and then students on IEP. Those are basically the three categories,
yes.
Right? Yep. Are there any other populations that we're looking at when we look at achievement gaps in grade school? I know we're going to go to high school later, so that's why I'm just trying to stick to grade school right now.
Yeah. I mean, those are the main ones that we're looking at in terms of achievement, but I think there's also things that we'd be looking at. I mean, we've talked in past meetings, for instance, even some of the issues of gender in some of the upper level STEM classes and things, how that plays out, different groups, how they're accessing honors and AP, even some of the kids with disabilities, that if it's a subject area, you know, I've looked at some of the data that where it may not be required to have a fourth year of that, but do they continue beyond that, or do they stop as soon as they are able to stop? So we look at all of that. But I would say, I mean, of the three, English language learners, income, all three are very important, but our largest group is the kids with disabilities.
The IEP group, so that's your 16% or so. And I'll wrap this up so we can move on, but just basically I wanted to, as we go through the rest of the presentation, help us understand, are we trying to prevent a problem, or are we trying to solve a problem? And if we're trying to, and they're both worthwhile goals, but help us understand as we go through the steps, and we're going to get into specifics later, and I don't want to get into that now, but as we go through the specifics, if you could help us understand what is a measure that, when do we see something that we're reacting to, either in the data, and it could be test data, it could also be the MTSS criteria we apply for student well-being, it could be I'm thinking broadly about performance, not just test data here, just how a student is doing. So where are we reacting to something we've seen, and help us understand that, because that helps us prioritize, understand why now and why this as a solution, and where are we, based on the evidence that you've presented, where are we adopting a best practice going forward? Because I think those are very different bases for the act we're taking. And as Chuck said, there were a number of parents that have raised this in public comment from different perspectives, and so I just want to make sure that everybody understands the thinking behind the changes as well as the changes.
Right.
That was a really, that was a really good point and a good way of framing it, because you're right. It's the same outcome, it's the same action, but what's driving it is a really good thought. Dr. Knight, I'm going to come to you in 1 second, but I wanted to follow up on this. I like Mr. Bovin's questions because they were so specific to Reading. What data are we using? What problems do we see in our student population? But I'd like to broaden it a little bit, because my impression is that closing the achievement gap, it exists in every district. It exists
Absolutely.
Statewide, and it in fact exists nationwide. I just would, for people who aren't immersed in education policy, I wouldn't want anyone watching this saying, boy, we have a very unique
That's a good
problem.
Point. No.
This
no.
is very,
right.
this is something
right.
that my perception Fair. Is getting a lot of attention at the state and national level of identifying groups of students that particularly need to be
it
focused
is.
On.
And often it's an issue of race or income in many of these other communities. And for us, I think the primary areas for students with disabilities.
Okay.
Thank
you. But it is a drive statewide, wouldn't you agree?
Absolutely.
Focusing
oh,
on
absolutely.
The achievement gap.
Yeah, across.
I believe it's one of the state goals that they have.
I hear about it a lot and read
yeah.
about it a lot. So
and I believe that's why the state has put it very directly into their accountability system, so that it forces us to look at that high needs group.
Right.
They have created that high needs group
yep.
of those three parts that force us to have that data. And when you, anyone who would look on the a school or district report card, you know, on the state website, you see the two bar graphs, and you see what progress has the all students group made, and what progress has the high needs group made, and are they the same or close, or is there a disparity there? And if there's a disparity, you get a little dinged for that, right? Because that's something that we need to be looking at. And I think we'll address some of the questions more, but just real briefly, I wanted to say, I mean, I said both. It absolutely is both preventative. And then also sort of, I don't want to say reactionary, but reactive, but depending on what level we're looking at. I mean, certainly when we're looking at some of the upper level courses, after a practice has already been in place, we want to sort of correct some things. But one of the reasons, too, that we're looking at the lowest levels and where some of these practices begin is because we want to make sure that we're using best practices to not create an issue. I mean, we are going to have students that at different times of their developmental readiness are going to run into some struggles. And so what are we doing to help them? If we get to a point where, I mean, I kind of, this is the way I always frame it in my mind. If we get to a point where we've identified a student at any grade level that, say, is about a year behind, a grade level behind, well, by definition, if a student is a grade level behind, if they are ever going to catch up, right, let's say in 4 years, they have to make 1.25 years of progress to catch up because they're already behind. So two things have, first of all, we want to make sure that we do anything possible to have as few kids as possible that fall behind. But if they do, we certainly don't want to put them in a situation where sometime over these next years, they're not going to make a good solid year's progress when really they have to make more than a year's progress at some point if they ever wish to catch up with most of their peers. So it's a little bit of both.
Thank you, Dr. Knight.
Yeah, this is more, I guess, procedural than theoretical, but, and I was out last year, obviously missed several meetings. When did we get notified that there was some of the classes were gonna be, some of the levels were gonna be collapsed at the high school?
Yes.
Yeah.
Mr. Barker came in, I can't remember the exact date.
We have I found January 5th, we did the math piece. But it might have been before then.
I mean, you're talking about social studies.
You're talking about a year ago.
Yeah.
He came in the fall
there was a note.
The previous year in his update for high school. Not this previous fall, but the fall before that, that they were talking about it.
Right. That would explain why I didn't know. Probably not here.
Any other questions for Mr. Martin? All right.
So let Mr. Bakker take over the next segment.
It was November 22nd last year.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for having us. Just to follow up first on Mr. Blobin's point, I think it's a good one. And in terms of, you know, preventing a problem or reacting to a problem, I think the margin of error is so close at times. You know, a couple of years ago, we were level two, and in looking at some of the subgroups that really put us into that boat, we put some, you know, some measures in there, some remediation measures to help. To get those kids back on track the following year, or kids like them, since the data is always a year behind. And, you know, I think the challenge is not sort of having that, as Mr. Martin said, that fixed mindset, because you solve the problem, but it's really just a quick fix. And looking a little bit more deeply at how do we prevent it from happening is the other charge. And so that's part of what drives this conversation on the achievement gap, is there is a need to have that short-term fix to get kids back on track, but then they'll look closer at, you know, what's causing that to begin with.
Yeah.
And so just to give you some information, initially I just want to show some of the data around the trends in local schools and state schools. So you can see this isn't, you know, we're by no means unique. As you said, Ms. Brodsky, this is certainly a state-level issue and a national issue. But the Middlesex high schools are also kind of going through this transformation. More than half, I think it's about 8 out of the 12 Middlesex high schools have already gone through this process. And we're trying to kind of pick their brain to make this as smooth a transition as possible. But you can see it's really the few at the bottom there, Stoneham, Lexington, Burlington, who are still in a three-level model. And statewide, we did the survey, Dr. Doherty did a survey with Air Superintendents, and about 48 high schools responded, and over 60% of those schools were, again, the same thing. They're now down to a two-leveled system. So again, it's, you know, not the entire state, but a good sample size to give you a sense of things. And just some more follow-up to, you know, what's the reason, what are the drivers behind this? You know, there are some real logistical things at the high school and other high schools that help. One of the things that, you know, we look at are the challenges around how many levels we offer, have each teacher can have a carry. And so when we run the schedule, because there'll be fewer levels, it just allows for teachers to be able to prepare better and give more feedback because there's fewer preps, what we call preps. And just give more of the attention to really being able to differentiate, being able to give more meaningful feedback because of the similarities in those different preps. The other thing is, as the schedule runs, it sometimes defaults to a computer that is just trying to find that perfect combination of what student A is requesting and what's actually available relative to class size. So by having more sections of the same level, once we've taken that lowest level out, we'll be creating more levels, more sections at the SCP level, more sections at the honors level. And that allows us to have more opportunities to distribute the kids more evenly. So there's a lot less of the kind of one-offs of a real low class size and then a higher class size, because there's more opportunities in our scheduling process to fill. Also, it just ensures that as a result of that, that we have more of an adequate support in that student-to-teacher ratio. Other reasons why the two levels seems to be a good thing at this point is it just giving more flexibility. So students make change in the schedule, which is often the case in the beginning of the semester, the beginning of the school year. One of the challenges we run into is there aren't any other sections of the same level available. So it's kind of more of the same, that we now will have more of the same sections that are available throughout the day instead of in just one period or one block or another. It's also, I think, you know, again, this is what Mr. Martin mentioned, we try very hard to make sure that all the levels are indeed college prep or strong college prep or honors. But there are certainly places, you know, when we talk to our department heads, when we talk to our students, when we look at the data, that lowest level is not consistently where, you know, where we want it to be in terms of college preparation, college and career readiness. By no means is that true across the board at the high school. We have some really challenging college prep level classes, but there are certainly, you know, areas where it's not always consistent. And the other thing is just really making sure that we don't have only a few of the smaller sections that are filled with students that really struggle with different behavioral issues or really need supports academically and end up being all condensed in one class, asking a lot of our teachers and asking a lot of their peers. Instead, we're better able to distribute students with those different issues in across more sections. And that allows, you know, teachers, again, to give better support. It allows, in many cases, we've seen it, where a student is kind of challenged up and some of the behavioral things amazingly go away. Peer pressure can be a very positive thing as well. Certainly, if a student is having real great academic struggles, then that doesn't just get corrected because of peer pressure. But some of our behavioral issues, when the kids aren't kind of reinforcing one another's negative behavior, it does improve that positive peer pressure. just some frequently asked questions we've already begun to entertain from teachers, from parents. First, really just the sense that our higher achieving students, will they be slowed down by students who are formerly in CP classes? And I think Mr. Martin touched upon that. The expectations will remain very rigorously strong college prep. There is no intention in kind of lowering the standard. What we are doing, you'll see it again in a moment, is making sure that we do a solid inventory and kind of audit and make sure that across our sections that SCP is the same, you know, that it isn't teacher dependent. So we're asking our department heads to work closely with teachers just to calibrate and make sure that SCP in, you know, in one subject is really truly consistent across that subject. But we are not going to be kind of watering down or diluting the standards. On the flip side, the question around, you know, will former CP students struggle at that next tier? You know, and our hope, and I think what we're trying to work on at the remainder of this year, is really identifying students who are most concerned with, who may really struggle potentially with that jump, and trying to drill down and understand exactly where their areas of struggle could be. So we're looking, instead of saying, well, the student is just having difficulty in school, looking very closely at, is it an executive functioning issue? And what supports could we build in, or what supports should we add on? Is it a literacy issue? And same thing, what kinds of things should we build into the student schedule, or what kind of tools and supports can we provide the teachers so that it's not taking or slowing down their work, but actually enhancing some of the work? Or is it a numeracy issue? Is it a behavior issue? But really trying to identify with a small group of students who we have the biggest concerns in that jump, proactively, how do we sort of build those supports and capacity the rest of this year, heading into next school year, on the student side, with extra help, with remediation, and also from the delivery of instruction side. Then the issue of class sizes has often come up. The concern that will your class sizes increase at the SCP level and become too big. And again, the hope is now with elimination of the CP level, we'll be able to offer more levels, sections of SCP and in honors. We don't predetermine how many sections there will be. We kind of wait for the scheduling process to take place, and then based on the number of requests, we would then dedicate, you know, X number of SCP sections, X number of honor sections. You know, we still obviously want to try and shoot for that 24 to 25 students per class. And because you have more sections, as I mentioned earlier, because there's more opportunities to fill that evenly, you know, our hope is that that will be maintain those numbers as they were, rather than the extremes that we would run into in the past because there were so few sections to offer. Then the issue around college admission chances, and just, you know, the worry, and certainly understandably so, around grades, the impact of grades. We talked to our folks in college admissions, we talked to our guidance counselors. We're always encouraging students to challenge up and to take more of a rigorous load of classes without going over the top and making it something that's causing such, you know, severe anxiety, stress, but also something that just they're not going to be successful in. But what we're finding, of course, is that, you know, a student who does challenge up, who may not get the exact same grade, maybe they get a C+ or a B- at a higher level, that colleges are more, see that more favorably, that the student is challenging themselves and the student is kind of making that upwards trend, versus just, you know, staying status quo, taking the easy route, and not necessarily pushing themselves the way they'll have to in a few short years. Certainly there's a point where the grade is a concern. If a student is, you know, in that C-, D range, then we obviously have those supports. And again, we're trying to proactively identify the kids where that jump will be a significant one. And then just kind of talking about the implementation plan thus far. So as we mentioned earlier, you know, last year was our first sets of conversation on our beginning the level collapse. So this current school year, there are two places where that's already taken place. In our English, senior level English classes, in an effort to try and create more choice for kids, to really make that senior year an enjoyable one, we've begun to already have now two levels. And so far, you know, Dr. Doherty was attending some classes. I've attended some of the classes at the end of the semester. They are semester-based. Very impressed with the heterogeneity of the classes. The rigor is there, the engagement is there, and the kids seem very ready to be successful. On the other end of things, the Social Studies 9 has also begun their work with the two-level model. So you've got SEP and honors there. And so far, the feedback there is consistent. The grades are consistent with what we've seen in terms of distribution. There's been no alarming feedback so far as well. So kind of a first place to get us, you know, we were talking to the teachers who have been in that setting. We're talking with the department heads who have helped to lead those, the two-level classes and those two grade levels, and just make sure that obstacles that we've run into, PD that's been needed, we don't have the learning curve that we might have without, you know, prior experience. As I mentioned a little bit earlier, part of the other implementation is really making sure that first and foremost our curriculum is aligned to the standards, that our assessments are aligned, and that we're really calibrated across the sections and can say this is what SEP looks like, this is what honors looks like, and that there's not a disparity based upon, you know, one specific teacher. We're also kind of trying to decide what a rubric looks like. We have a rubric that's in the program of studies, and it was, you know, really an effort a few years back to make kind of a one-size-fits-all. And what we're finding in conversations is there really needs to be differentiation across the departments, that while, you know, the spirit of a rubric for each level certainly needs to be consistent, that what a rubric looks like, a meaningful, detailed rubric of SCP in science, is going to be very fundamentally different than a rubric of the same level in English. And in order to make it meaningful, it needs to be extremely detailed. And so department heads have been engaging teachers in that conversation. And really, again, that's to calibrate, to make sure that before we really kind of look to see if this is working or not, when we have this level collapse, that the tools to measure that are accurate. And then similarly, we're then looking more deeply at the individual units and trying to see lessons, units, assessments that we can make those assessments and units more approachable, more accessible to students of different levels, of different modes of learning, who kind of excel in different modes, and not simply, you know, have one standard traditional test that's the only measure, or one lesson that's the only measure. So trying to provide teachers with the tool bag of differentiation, of inclusivity, is really our goal. And we have a number of teachers who do this very, very well, and we hope to sort of see them in a training role in the months and the year to come. Also, again, as I mentioned, so guidance counselors for the rest of this year, we just got our semester one data back, are really trying to identify students, and this also extends to students in grade eight. So our friends in the middle school are just trying to really identify, again, those kids who are most concerned. They do this anyway, but now it's more of an eye towards, okay, if there were two levels, you know, who are the kids that you really have the greatest concern? What this often helps us to see is I think it helps us shine a light on students, especially behavioral concerns, who are very bright when you look at their standardized tests. They do very well, they're very, you know, have great capacity. Sometimes the maturity, academic maturity, work habits are the area that we most need to kind of emphasize and support, and making sure that we don't just use a level as the intervention and kind of slow down their progress, and in some cases actually worsen their progress. Mm-hmm. Because we fed into that fixed mindset. Also, so again, we're looking just to brainstorm different ways to support those incoming CP students, and continuing now to really prioritize our professional development plan in the months that we have, and then next school year, how we can build in a PD plan that is really enhancing teachers' work the next day, that's not, you know, overly steeped in the theoretical, but is really some useful tools and a useful model that can help me tomorrow in the classroom. And so our hope is that we're gonna be able to free teachers up next school year in a model that we used last school year. And so what we did was try to kind of create a cohort of teachers by freeing up teachers from some hallway duty and assuming some of that work elsewhere by administration and just by some of our procedures around hall passes, so that teachers can really be working on more meaningful things, whether it's giving feedback or next year really looking at talking with one another and having some lead teachers continue to help work on enhancing differentiated instruction techniques, looking at assessment, differentiate assessment techniques. We'd like to identify teachers who do a lot of this already, as I mentioned earlier, but build some capacity around facilitating adult work with some of our the trainers that we've used in the past. And so we're trying to finalize that now in the last few months here. But we'll hopefully offer some of that time also in the summer for those lead teachers. And as we return in the fall, those structures will be built in. We'll have lead teachers assuming some of that responsibility, administrators assuming some of that facilitation, and then have less of a cost with outside consultants. The remainder of this year, that will be a cost that we'll need to incur just to get the ball rolling and help with that process. Again, we're working with other Middlesex League high schools that have helped identify some good online supports in terms of PD around differentiated instruction. We are meeting twice a week with our department heads just to make sure the progress in these remaining months is where it should be in terms of the time dedicated to this. Earlier this year, we began a partnership with a partner that DESE uses called CAST Professional Learning Group. And what they're really doing is helping not just with differentiated instruction, which is somewhat of a reactive approach, but really changing the framework to something called universal design for learning. So really for all students, regardless of level, trying to better understand, you know, how do we develop curriculum, how do we develop assessments that are, you know, just really accessible for all different learners, regardless of their different needs. And the hope is that will really enhance the department head's capacity to be a lead coach in next year's work as well. So common language, common approach, common differentiated instruction understanding.
Yeah, I mean, just to wrap it up, the quote there, you know, this is from an article several years ago for Edutopia. This writer said, you know, all educators are so familiar with the phrase, this battle cry, all children can learn. And this is about really taking these words and putting them into action. You know, he says in this article that to really put these things, this philosophy into action, we know what's required to do it. It takes effort. It takes a real commitment. That's why I began by really commending our staff and our district to be willing to go through this work. He says there in that second excerpt that I have there that because this research, this evidence has been around for years, he's wondering if closing the achievement gap is more of a will gap than a knowledge gap, because the evidence over the last several years has really been mounting, especially in the age of accountability, where there's been a big focus on this, that the schools, districts, communities that are doing this work are seeing some pretty meaningful results. And so I'm really thrilled that we're taking some of the steps to make this a reality.
Well, thank you very much for that.
Yeah, sure.
It was a great presentation. I think Mr. Robinson has questions.
Yeah, can you go back to that, I don't know, it's the slide where it had the different towns? So I'm just curious, like with Arlington, for example, is Advance, was that equivalent to our SCP?
I could see the other way. It was?
Advance and then Honors? What's that? No, it wouldn't be the other way.
If it is, it's listed in reverse order of all the other ones, but.
Oh, yeah, maybe
it is listed reverse, but Advance
okay.
is equivalent to Strong.
Okay.
And I think you might have hit on it at the end, Adam, but I guess I was maybe answered my question. I was concerned that we're adding what you call lead teachers, and I was trying to figure out what are the department heads going to do? Are they both going to do it? Or because I guess.
Yeah. It's always the tricky part of using the word lead teacher because it has so many different meanings. I think, Mr. Roberts, I think what we're trying to do is just make sure that we validate teachers who are already doing this very well.
Yeah.
And make sure that we use the in-house talent. So if you have, let's say there's four teachers teaching English 9, and they're often working together anyways, that you know, that we just identify and kind of validate the maybe one person who's interested in kind of taking on a lead role and supporting that group. and would complement the department head who's kind of doing it at the department level. So they, you know, wouldn't be, wouldn't be as though one were not helping at all, but it would just be to complement it more specifically at that course level.
So is there a budget implication to that? No.
No, I believe the way I understood is that they may be relieved of some of their duties.
Correct.
All right.
So you're relieved of some of the duties. We have our professional development budget would help to just provide them with some of the training.
Duties, not teaching, but like you said, hall or lunch or.
Yeah, lunch duty, hall duty, bathroom duty.
Okay.
I have a question about this slide since we're on it. The ones that are at two levels, do you have a sense of how many of them have recently moved to two levels or how many have always been at two levels? I'm trying to get a sense of trend.
Yeah. So we're actually meeting, the Middlesex League principals were supposed to have met 2 weeks ago, I guess it was now, but we got snowed out. So that question is high on the list of priorities. I do know that Wilmington, I believe, just went through this process.
As did Winchester.
In Winchester. So, but yeah, that's the question I would be asking.
I'll be interested to hear it. Wilmington is what prompted it. I taught at Wilmington 10 years ago and they had three levels. Yep. So when I saw two, I went, oh, that's new.
Yeah.
So I'd be interested to know, my sense from at least, it's anecdotal, but I'd be curious to see if this really is something that's very much trending. It sounds like
In conversations I've had with superintendents, most of this has happened in the last 3 to 4 years.
Yeah.
Is it, can I, I'm just on that, sorry. So if we put Reading up there, it's going to say honors and strong college prep or college prep?
Strong college prep.
Okay.
And we talked about that. I mean, some of it is just the messaging around.
Right.
The confusion around that we eliminate that, you know, that middle level. Ultimately, it probably would say college prep.
I think you're wise to avoid that confusion, though.
Right.
Mrs. Webb.
Yeah, I think you had part of the answer, but I think it's just really important when when we look at other districts, right, that have made the transition, and we're looking at their data and their experience, and we're using that to impact our planning and our process. So I think you're saying you're doing all that. You've done some of that, and you're doing that, and you're using Department of Elementary Secondary Education and specifically this CAST resource, which is a professional resource.
Yeah, which is a resource that we're actually using at no cost as a result, I believe, of our accountability status.
Yes.
So we're getting access to that technical resource as well.
Mm-hmm.
So just in a little more building on Mr. Robinson's question, so the department heads, I was trying to just also understand, will are the department heads as well as these lead teachers that you're trying to garner be getting this same professional development? So the department heads are also participating in this?
So what CAST, they sort of have this implementation plan of their own, and they kind of do an economy of scale. So they try to work with a group of, say, 10 teachers,
mm-hmm.
and then in year two, they would look to expand that to a wider group of teachers in hopes of embedding, you know, the different techniques. So we're actually still meeting, having a separate meeting on implementation with the CAST leadership in a couple of weeks. But they're supportive in the model we have because we have currently those department heads acting as coaches. So they attended three full day workshops, kind of understanding the theory around universal design, then more of the practical specific strategies, and then what are the best ways to actually distribute that information to teachers.
So can I just, don't we have resources in special education that are probably very familiar with universal design, or maybe do I not, I might not truly understand universal design. Thinking about it like design in the workplace, like ergonomics.
Very similar. But it is more in the general education setting. So when you're thinking about universal design, it is very similar to the idea of architecture and looking at the workplace. So it's looking at lesson planning and making it accessible to all learners.
Okay.
So you're starting at the beginning of your planning to make it accessible to all learners. So special educators might have some background in that, but they may also be more focused on specialized interventions versus designing a history lesson in grade 10.
Okay.
So
you touched upon an important point, Ms. Webb. I think again, like I said earlier, some of the in-house talent that does do this well will be excellent candidates for that lead teacher kind of role.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly some of our educators in special education kind of have a leg up as it's just been part of their training.
Right, it would seem like you could really benefit from having some of those people in some of these training sessions,
yep.
even if it was perhaps, you know, stuff that they know 80% of it, but they might really, it might just benefit our community, yeah, to
yeah.
have them there and
absolutely.
Really leveraging that. I have a bunch of questions, but I'll...
We've got a few, we've got a little bit of a line. I'm just going to make a quick editorial comment. Something I like about the lead teacher model is I think teaching is a profession that can be very hard to find advancement if you don't go the administrative route. Like, that's the natural advancement. So if you can find opportunities for teachers to be leaders within the classroom and with their peers, I think generally that's a good philosophy. So I like that. Mr. Bobbin.
I'll stick with this topic of what I'll call benchmarking here that we're talking about where we're looking at these other schools. My impression here is that this is, I'm hearing about a best practice. Is that a fair characterization of how you're viewing this transition, as we're adopting a best practice that many other schools have already adopted?
I think that's fair.
And so when we look at these other schools, just to be clear, we're also going from 4 to 3 levels, not 3 to 2 overall, because we're keeping AP.
Correct.
Right? So yes. I don't want that to get lost in the
well,
in the discussion.
And I assume these most, if not all,
yeah.
of these
yeah.
have AP
they
as
all
well.
Have
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. yeah. Just
exactly.
Yeah.
I just don't want parents
they
like, oh my
AP.
Gosh, there's no.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't want people to miss that.
Oh, levels not. Yeah.
We're not touching
AP.
That's a very good point.
Okay. So my question is around, you know, if I just do in my head and. There's a chart that I found helpful in the budget when I was looking at these slides. It's just, for the record, it's figure 27. It just has the class averages for class sizes for 16, 17. And it's got college prep, strong college prep, honors, AP, and then we're going to take the college prep piece and we're going to move it into strong college prep. So in my mind, there's a kind of a matrix format to the chart, right, where you have 4 grades, 3 subjects, 12 boxes. Okay, so 2 of those boxes we've already moved. 12th grade English, 9th grade social studies, right? So those are out. So we have 10 boxes left.
Yeah.
So I guess my question is, why these subjects and why all at once? Is that the best practice? It just seems like a lot to go, or maybe it's not, but to go from a prototype pilot group of 2 of the cohorts to go up to, we're going to do everybody else now this year. Do we feel we know what we need to understand about our students, about our teachers, about our district to make that transition, or is that just very much the way the other districts did it?
Yeah, I mean, I think some of it is budget related in terms of the urgency.
Okay.
We certainly, I don't know if
In an ideal world, we would be phasing this in 1 grade at a time.
Okay.
Very similar to what we're doing in math with 7th grade. But unfortunately, we're not in a situation where we can do that. And
so
that's been the plan for the last couple of years, and then we had this the budget situation.
So I'll tie up the benchmark topic and we can move on to other topics. But so it's not benchmark driven, it's just budget driven, and maybe that's a good segue into the budget questions we have and some of those.
I think it's a little bit of both.
Oh.
I think the budget is driving the pace of it.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Correct.
The budget
sense?
Is accelerating
and this
the implementation.
The subjects we've selected, English, science, social studies, these are the same subjects that these other, is the best practice for those subjects. I'm just wondering if there's a subject-specific element here.
That question, we have not talked to the other schools about. It's more around just some of the challenges that students have run in, specifically into math. We've had similar conversations even in science with the real math-heavy sciences, like physics, you know,
yeah.
those actually, you know, be similar challenge courses. So that's why for now, we stayed away from math. For foreign language, you know, that real cumulative nature, similar things, and just focused instead on more of the skill-heavy in English and in social studies. I think science is the one that we're trying to figure out best in terms of pace.
If I can just add to that,
sure.
Our feeling is if what we're doing in middle school right now in math,
yeah.
that eventually we'll reach a point where we can do some reduction in math at the high school in levels.
Dr. Doxer.
So I actually appreciate the potential for some students to have this collapsing of groups, speaking as someone who didn't test well and was put in less challenged levels when I was in junior high school a long time ago, and then I fought very hard to be able to have learning opportunities that challenged me and did not find those until I got to high school. And we had unleveled classes like the wonderful Missing Voices here. Then it was psychology. There were other classes that enabled me to break that ceiling that I had encountered. My question is around the logistics. You said that you're going to be evaluating students and watching to see what supports are necessary going in. That, my question is about that. So budget-wise and personnel-wise, what are those supports going to look like and how are we going to make them happen? And then also, the process of figuring out what level students are going to go into from, like you mentioned, going from middle school to the high school. There have been questions about do you encourage a student to try up, to aspire to harder, or how do you decide what level students will go to in their next grade and what kind of supports will we have available if they decide they want to aspire up?
Yeah, so we just actually, Ms. Williams and I just met with the eighth graders, and then of course we had future freshman night, and that was a hot topic of discussion is how to find the balance, you know, between challenging up and not over challenging oneself. So you know, what we encourage kids and families to do certainly is to first rely heavily on the teachers' feedback, teachers' recommendation. But I think, too, it's also, again, making sure that our metric is right, our rubric is accurate and detailed enough that parents and kids and even teachers and counselors can really gauge what level in terms of independence, in terms of initiative, in terms of requisite skills to make the best decision possible. We also know that, you know, there are times that it just doesn't work out and we've got to make an adjustment, whether that be an adjustment level, if it's appropriate, or whether it be interventions. And this year, I think with our schedule change, that's provided a lot of built-in time to provide support during the flex block, which we've increased to be 3 times a month, and then also our weekly, you know, office hour time. And so we have an eye towards, even in this semester now, really trying to identify a teacher, department head, a few people in each department whose charge really is that kind of as interventionist in lieu of a duty, in lieu of administrative responsibilities. The logistics around that are parts that are being continued to kind of be worked out. But coming into next school year, that will really be our dedicated plan, is that in some way, shape, or form, each department, at least 1, 2, 3 folks will have that as their responsibilities, providing really that support, that remediation, and again, in lieu of a duty, so it's at zero cost. I think the question that remains is, where's that tipping point where that time is not enough? And that's what we're trying to understand these last months, is really looking at both on the curriculum and assessment side, where are places that are going to just be, where there may be such big gaps in terms of requisite skill, in terms of information, that we've got to do something more than, you know, wait for the shoe to drop. And that may look like, you know, that may look like an extra dose of math, that may look like an extra dose of literacy, that may look like an extra dose of, you know, a support around executive functioning, that we, you know, we use our resources, our staff, and build that into their schedule. So those are the things that we're still trying to kind of work out, but conceptually, that's our point.
Mr. Robinson?
Good.
Dr. Doxer.
Just to follow up on that, I know that you've had these parent nights. I also suspect, having been there from a different direction, that it's very hard for parents with change to know how to support their children and guide them in these decisions. can you talk a little bit about the supports that you've talked about, the professional development and the network you're building for the teachers? What kinds of supports are you able to provide for the parents through this change process? Because I also know how much you all have on your plates.
Everybody's busy, right? So right now we're just beginning to communicate. Some communication that went out at the different guidance nights, I think sophomore night and upcoming junior night, just starting to touch upon the fact that this is happening. Then the communication came, you know, from my office to parents right around the scheduling time, just explaining again some of what we saw here tonight, and the logistics for next school year and what we're doing in the remaining months. But I think you're right that we need to continue to just provide communication. Tomorrow at PTO, this is the topic we have that's on the agenda. So we'll have a little bit more time to talk and answer parents' questions. But I think, you know, a series of information nights that will just give folks a chance to come in and ask questions. Individually, I think the best route still remains talking to teachers. For the parents and students to be talking to teachers, talking to counselors around what their recommendation is regarding levels. And then, you know, I would suspect in the next month or so, we'll have a real detailed rubric that we'll send out to families so that they, you know, can again look. It's a little bit after the fact, but we're building it as we're flying it, so to speak. But I think if we see, you know, if parents see that they need to make an adjustment level, better to do that now than, you know, in the first 2 weeks of the school year where, you know, course changes are rampant.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Mrs. Martin, can you put that slide up that I sent you?
Oh, yeah.
I just wanted to...
I'm not connected, but I could send it over.
Oh.
You just wanted to see the math sequencing?
I wanted to show the math. We're talking about the math, because I think one of the things that I'm hearing, I think this was, well, back in January we saw this, and then, you know, previously in November we had talked about this process. That I know when Trace Keane talked about the math pathway, you know, one of the things that he talked about was, and we've talked about, is that, you know, students develop at different levels and they have a capacity to embrace and sort of, you know, get it at different times. So one of the things that I see this, the methodology in terms of the focus on the students and really looking at, you know, sort of what are the students' needs in terms of how are they going to be successful at this level. The other thing that could be a real benefit is right now you have a student who might go into Algebra 1 in ninth grade, and they may, it may just really click for them, and they may really accelerate. And I think if we're having enough of the dialogue and we're really sort of like using the universal design and we've got this mindset of differentiated instruction, then it's going to come naturally that there'll be a dialogue with that teacher, with the student, and the family to say, you know, there's an option for you to, it's down on the chart, but, you know, to then take, you know, analytic geometry instead of geometry and put them in a little bit different pathway. So I think, I know that when Trey presented that, he talked about it, but I think that this would, theoretically, it could help do that.
I think your suggestion of putting that presentation with this one on the website is a smart one, because they're very connected.
Yeah, and I specifically, there's just a few, this chart, is the one that I think, you know, people have questions about. So that's what I see, you know, we don't always, people get very stuck thinking that you get stuck in a row. You don't have to be stuck in a row on this chart. And what you're talking about doing with students in a classroom is being able to identify when you need to shift, and it could go the other way too. And kids go throughout their career, and they might decide in 10th grade, you know, that I really want to have a different focus. I'm not going to be so math focused. Maybe I want to focus in a different way. So I think it just it should theoretically help us help students be a little bit more fluid in the pathways.
We also, in that same slide sequence, because I just was bringing it up here, also reminded me we had a statement from the president of the National Council of Teachers of Mathematics that talked about if, it's not if but when kids take algebra. And she ends this, then the slide by saying, my experience both as a student and as a teacher leads me to believe that we do more harm than good by placing students in a formal algebra course before they are ready. And so the sequence that we have now, that they will absolutely get that
right.
fully aligned, rigorous Algebra 1 course, either in 8th or 9th grade, and either way is going to work for them.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Susser?
I was just following up with one of the things, sort of off this, back to where we were. You had mentioned that parents were building it as we're flying it, and so parents are learning it as we're going along as our teachers. So my question was, in terms of adjustment, you also said better to adjust now than in the fall. What is going to be the window for parents to do any of their adjustments with their kids and meet? Does it go into the summer, or is it by the end of this year?
So, I mean, we usually strive to have it done end of May, but there are changes into the summer. There are changes, obviously, in the next school year. So I think what we're trying to do is just prioritize the changes that are based on, you know, a group of students where we just have the greatest concerns. Or, you know, some of the students, you know, with that accurate rubric kind of with parents and teachers and counselors, who counselors just began their two-week process of meeting with kids and kind of finalizing course selection. But really, that may be the next month, month and a half, may be the time where we see the most change and adjustment, because it's all kind of happening.
Mm-hmm.
It's all kind of coming together where teachers will have kind of looked at their curriculum, looked at their, identified the rubric and been able to kind of compare their selections to what we ultimately agree to. Counselors will have gone through that process and acquainted themselves with this new kind of rubric and measure. And parents the same, and students the same thing. So I could definitely foresee a lot of change in the next, changing course levels in the next month or so.
Yeah. Mr. Nyan, were you waiting?
Yeah, so I just want to state theoretically, you know, I think it's a great idea. But I'm also, you know, in listening to your presentation and thinking about it too, having been in a situation where we, you know, work on schedules collaboratively at the high school level. What in the challenges that schedules, trying to put together a schedule that makes a lot of sense and provides, the, meets the needs of all students. But so I guess my point is, how much do you think, I'm not talking just about Reading, I'm talking about this in general, how much has this change been, you know, procedurally driven, I guess is the word, or academically driven? What do you, I mean, the achievement gap makes sense to me, and I do believe everything that you stated about challenging students and putting them in, you know, as opposed to, I mean, it goes back to the whole concept when you go way back to special education when there were self-contained classrooms.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, my having seen the significant improvement when students have been dispersed throughout regular education. Anyways, what's your thoughts on that?
I think philosophically, you know, having taught in both an unleveled environment and a very leveled environment, you know, there the tricky part is there's a point where if you just have one level, you know, the gap is so great that it's almost too much for a teacher to try to reconcile the two extremes. I think on the other hand, when you have so many levels, it's almost impossible not to have that kind of Pygmalion effect. The kids who are the lowest level, they identify themselves as being less capable of being in this category, which is certainly an impact that goes well beyond schooling. And so trying to find a way that is, you know, a few levels to account for those big differences, but more, I think more accurately, it's having a very responsive common measure to look at, you know, what kids' growth is, what kids' progress is, and then following that, when kids struggle or dip below what the expectation is, a very quick and responsive intervention. Plan of intervention. So I think that's where, you know, we've tried over the past couple of years to really fine tune and tweak our student support team, some of the metrics, and identifying kids quickly in collaboration with teachers to see where we've got to kind of pull the brakes, provide some support, whatever the issue might be. but not get, not be so quick to say, oh, the student needs to drop a level, which in the past was very commonly an intervention recommended, whether, you know, sometimes by teachers, sometimes by parents, or you're worried about the grades, sometimes by counselors. We're trying to find a more accurate and precise way to support students by better understanding why they're struggling to begin with, and then finding a way to more accurately give them supports with time that's built in. And so I think there is a need for some leveling, but I think if it's so broad, it just becomes an easy out for all of us and too quick of an intervention that doesn't prove very effective at all.
So it sounds like it's academically driven, but the benefits are also the scheduling. It allows the scheduling to be a little bit more flexible.
I mean, separately, that certainly wouldn't be the driver, but it's a nice complementary feature that with fewer sections, with fewer levels, you're able to offer more sections.
Right. Makes sense. Yeah, I can definitely see that. And then the last thing that it typically is something I tend to point out is, you know, we have great ideas and, you know, go about doing the best we can to implement them, but I'm always worried about capacity. And, you know, I think whatever we can do to support that, it's not going to be financially, of course, but, you know, any creative thinking, collaboration that can occur, I know you'll work hard at that. One more question, actually, too, is which districts have had the most, I know Dr. Daugherty said it's been around four or five years that this idea has percolated. What do you hear from school districts that have been doing it for a while? I've heard like mixed reviews on it, but.
Yes, the last.
Anecdotally, by the way, not necessarily, yeah. You know, valid data, but go ahead.
The last district I worked in had been doing it for upwards of 5-6 years. Mm-hmm. And again, for the most part, the students, the leveling was not the issue, the intervention and support was the issue at times. But that, you know, it did provide students, I think, an expectation that was truly college driven, that was rigorous, and I think that's what we all want to see, mm-hmm. is that kids aren't closing themselves away from options after high school. It's, I think, where sometimes it falls short, as I mentioned a minute ago, is providing timely supports, to providing accurate diagnosis of what's going on. And again, sometimes behavior rules the day. A lot of times the behavior, whether it be disruption, whether it be just coming to class prepared, often disguises itself, you know, and causes a student to be dropped one level or moved to a different course, and I think that's something that we just have to resist that and provide, you know, some of the training we're looking at is cooperative discipline, you know, and really making sure that we try and understand why that behavior is happening, and that many, many, many times we're surprised to find out the student is very capable, but needs a different approach.
That's good to know that you've had 5 or 6 years of experience going into this, as opposed to flying by the seat of your pants, so it's good to know.
Sometimes we do that, though.
So I heard Mr. Nyan say that we don't have the finances, which, of course, is a true statement. We just set the budget with needing more money to do what we need to do in FY18. So, but I really have some concerns about making sure that we have identified the costs. And I heard, you know, there'll be some gains that and efficiencies, the result of sort of that procedural efficiency that you get, although this is academically and student driven. But I don't know that those gains are enough to offset the supports that we really need to be able to provide teachers and students to really effectively execute this. And so I think, you know, as we move forward, we need to make sure that we're really capturing what that cost is, and we need to be calling it out in Ms. Sprowski's budget message. You know, our budget message, it calls out that we cannot keep doing these kinds of things. And this is exactly the kind of thing that, in my mind, we would not be able to keep doing unless we can, you know, really get the funding we need.
And it's really, it's such an amazingly great way to utilize the resources, because you're increasing the capacity of the teachers right where it needs to be increased with the student, at the student execution level. And so I don't know what I'm just saying. Do we know, like, do we have, is, will there be a number at some point that says, you know, look, we need this, we need this kind of resource? And maybe after you go through that and you use the CATCO training and, you know, you talk to the other districts, you might hear some things about, you know, how they provide some interventions, or, you know, Carolyn may have some suggestions. But I think we're going to need to be putting some numbers around it and resources.
Yeah, CAST has provided us a great resource in spite of, obviously, the difficulty around why we're able to use it.
Right.
With the accountability rating, and then the school city has some funds, I believe, that's helping, that will help us with some of the inclusive practices that are online.
Grant funding.
Grant funding.
And so, we are fortunate to have that. We've talked a little bit to PTO. We have professional development funds in this year's operating budget that still remain. But you're right, it certainly is a cost that we need to be mindful or conscious of that's sustainable. And I think that's what, you know, we're working on finalizing those figures.
Maybe I misunderstood. I mean, this isn't the tail wagging the dog here. We knew about this when we built the budget.
Correct.
That we were going to do this. So this isn't a...
I'm talking about for next year, I think.
The efficiencies is coming from the budget reduction, just so you know. That's where we're getting the budget reduction.
From the efficiencies by reducing the level.
1.4 FTE.
Right. I understand that. I think I'm thinking like FY19. I'm just thinking ahead that we need to just make sure that we, you know, are providing that support.
Oh, sure, of course.
Just as I think about it, and knowing that there are many parents who are watching this at home, as far as the parent support, I just want all of you guys to know that starting last year, the guidance counselors meet with every student for the course selection process, and so we started that today. And it's a new process that it's online, where the teachers get to put in their input, the student puts in what they want, the parent puts in whether they agree or disagree, and they can make comments, and then we get to see it as well. But one of the things that I just want to emphasize is that the teachers are there as a support to the students and the parents, as well as the guidance counselors. So we've already started receiving phone calls from parents just asking about, like, what is our opinion as far as the difference in the levels, what would we recommend their child, and really what we're doing is we're basing it off of the individual child, so not just their grade. So if they got an A in a subject, how did they get that A, and what are their strengths, and trying to figure out in what particular subject, should they stay the same level, should they move up a level, and things like that. So parents, you're out there, feel free to give us a call or contact the teachers. And I know today, where we start off with freshmen, and then we gradually move to meeting with juniors. And so the conversations get a little bit more in depth as we move along. But we're anticipating that there's more questions that are going to come our way, and so we're ready for that. So I just wanted to let you know that support, in addition to the parent nights and presentations, is something we're doing.
I guess I was thinking also, I know you're meeting with the PTA, but I mean PTO, but I know that those meetings are not, you know, there's not 50 people that attend those meetings. It's, you know, 12. Yeah. So I was just wondering if there's opportunity to leverage the types of sessions that you do, Dr. Daugherty, some of those, like, coffees, and maybe there's just one or two that is about this with Adam as a special guest or something. I don't know whether that would be more efficient or less efficient in terms of, you know, your time, or whether it's just, you know, parents are gonna make phone calls. I know I had a question today from a close friend whose students are in the district, and math, the advice that the guidance counselor, it was very, what I saw was very rich, very thoughtful, and it was very, it showed that the guidance counselor had a very good knowledge of this process that's being laid out. So I thought it was, you know, it was very, it was excellent.
To answer your question and to piggyback on what Linda said, I think what's most important is that you have the guidance counselor speaking to the parent.
Parents, yeah.
Rather than having a general conversation. Mm-hmm. The other night I did have a couple of parents at office hours ask me some questions about this. And all I can really do is give them a more general answer.
Right.
Because I don't know the specifics about their child. Mm-hmm. So I had to direct them to Mr. Barker who,
right.
who gave them a call. So
right.
I think the process that's in place
yeah.
is the best process.
Right, because the guidance counselor
not
is
that we
really
don't want to answer
no.
the questions. I just don't have that knowledge mm-hmm. For the individual student.
And what we don't know about the student's strengths and stuff, we're going back to the teachers
right.
to find out what's, you know, what their feedback is and why they made certain decisions.
Right, and ultimately really involving the parent and the student to be very thoughtful and introspective about, you know, like you said, what are they doing to get that C plus or B minus or A minus? What, you know, what is it taking them and what is it? And so it is a bigger, it's more than just what's on the paper, but it has to mean all of that.
This has been a really good conversation and a good presentation. I think there's a couple more questions, Mr. Bobbin.
Yeah, I just wanted to address some numbers that are floating around my head. I'm thinking about scalability of what we're endeavoring to do here. It's pretty ambitious, right? You have 1,200 plus students at the high school. I suspect most of them take most of these core subjects most of the time. I don't know the numbers exactly, but if we have statistically, say, 15% of those students on IEPs, maybe a few more that require other supports here that we're going to have to accommodate in some way, are we ready for the scale that could be the number of kids? So if we take a class of, say, 24, 25, 26 kids, and we say we're going to add into that, before, let's say, I'm just looking at the numbers from that figure 27 again, and we had sizes of around 22 strong college prep, 22 to, there's 126, but mostly around 22, 23 students per class, whereas in the college prep, there were much smaller classes, like 14 to 18 average. So you're taking students who were previously taught in a smaller classroom, statistically, moving some of them, let's say, you know, four or five, into a class that's bigger with one teacher. And I'm just wondering, are the teachers ready for that? Do you feel they're ready? Is that a challenge that they're ready for? And if we're going to provide support for the students outside of that classroom in slide 12, do the teachers have time if they're going to be pulled off a duty or other obligations? Is this creating more instructional time? Is it who's going to mind the bathrooms or whatever these other things that need to be due? Like, do we have enough bodies to accommodate all the student need here? What have you thought about?
Yeah, it's a good question. So some of our supports around liaisons with our students who have IEPs, our co-teachers, that those structures will still remain and, you know, will be the best point of contact for a lot of the kids that we anticipate may have some difficulty. A lot of it is the hope around really being proactive and preventative by enhancing teachers' capacity, or I think making sure that it's a more consistent model for all teachers in differentiating instruction. And the way that, you know, the curriculum, the lessons, and the assessments are actually approached to prevent head-off some of those challenges. But certainly there will be, you know, some of the examples you mentioned, there will be kids who struggle. And I think, you know, that's the place that there will be a little bit of a learning curve. And I think what we're trying to do is this year, use the remainder of this year to really kind of look through that lens of, you know, well, next year there won't be this last level to move kids to as a worst case scenario. What will we do instead? And trying to see, you know, is it behavioral? Is it literacy? Is it numeracy? Is it executive functioning? And use some of the remaining time for the rest of this year to get those students ready for the jump. And then as the end of this year closes, I think having a clear plan of, I do imagine to be a relatively small group of kids who will need a built-in support, you know, that may look like, you know, once a cycle there's an additional dose of math or literacy, and just using some of our support staff to give that time. That will be the hope, but it will definitely be a bit of a learning curve and adjustment around some of those extremes. And in terms of the supervision piece, I mean, we've tried to tighten up procedures around the hall time, bathroom usage halls. And, you know, we make it a point as best we can administratively to be visible and around the halls and have a pretty good core of staff who really do assist us in that capacity. So when we look at next year, people will be interventionists, for lack of a better word. We'll stay away from, you know, folks who really, you know, don't mind and enjoy that work, whether it's in the CAF, whether it's in the halls. We do have plenty of folks who enjoy that setting too with the kids. So. But there will be definitely, I think, an ongoing check to see what we need to adjust, where we need to, you know, make some tweaks.
Dr. Duxer?
So two things. One was just quickly, from what I'm hearing, I'm loving that the placements are not going to be just primarily based on standardized tests or testing. It's going to be on the whole child, seeing
Absolutely.
Where their strengths are and the different triangulating around the information to place them in the best possible situation. So I'm thrilled to hear that. The other question that keeps going through my mind is that this feels like a huge challenge for the teachers going forward. Mm. Because it's a different mix of students. And I'm just wondering if you have a sense of what their concerns are. I'm hearing that you're doing professional development to accommodate what they need, the skills they need to get up to do this job. But I'm just wondering what the concerns are that they have and where they're at in this shift.
The biggest concern is the pace at which we're doing. And I think it's the extremes, you know, some of the kids with the greatest gaps. But I think truthfully, some of it is just natural fear and anxiety around change. Having been in a two-level model, you know, our kids can do a lot here. And I think, you know, some of that is just taking the plunge. But I think it's the pace of it that we're all a little anxious about. We're just trying to do our best to head that off. And by pace, I mean giving folks adequate time to really let that professional development absorb, plan lessons that, you know, are differentiated well enough, assessments that are varied enough that instead of the one, there's three or four different routes a student can take to demonstrate understanding. I think that's the greatest source of anxiety. And then in subjects specifically math-centered, I think, where skills are a little bit more screed or, you know, requisite knowledge is a little bit more concrete. I think that's where we've heard the kids' concerns too around, you know, how will we be able to reconcile if that gap in math or math-related subjects is too great. And so we're trying to really dig a little bit more deeply than just say, oh, they're not going to be able to do it. Oh, it's because of math. Oh, you know, really say, well, let's take a close look at in what area of math. And could we fill the gap in with a six-week support or remediation or an every other day or once a week cycle, a once a cycle intervention. And, you know, I think Ms. Webb's comments around budget is important, you know, in future years, because it certainly would make it a lot easier. But I think we have to first really dig deeply to see what exactly is the issue for student X, Y, Z, and how, you know, how difficult would it be to provide a little extra help in one area of whichever topic or, you know, subject we're talking about.
As a school committee member, I wish we could be providing more of those resources.
We appreciate that.
Mr. Blavin?
Also, is there any effort to look at how evenly this CP population is distributed than the SCP population so you don't get a lot more kids in one class than another as we do our scheduling?
Yep, absolutely. And so we sort of, the computer does its thing, and then much of the weeks that follow are manual adjustments from counselors, from our registrar, from, you know, administration, well into the summer to make sure. And we do take into account, at least last year we talked to our teachers to make sure, even, you know, all the way down to the level of student groups, student, what's the right word, kids that we know don't necessarily get along well together or won't thrive well together.
There you go.
You're trying to make sure that those pairings are supportive of both the teacher and the students. The trouble was with few sections, you didn't have a lot of options without having to blow up a kid's whole schedule. So that is one of the real benefits that has a couple positives.
Which just is, I was just gonna add, I mean, just especially for incoming ninth grade, as somebody who was a principal at the middle level for many years, that that's very close to the process that's happening in eighth grade with scheduling. And if you have, you know, X number of students that have been identified as struggling or have disabilities or so forth, that you need to know who those kids are so that you're able to distribute three or four to a class. Because the challenge to me really is making sure that those identified kids all make it to point B, right, in that progress. And that's a challenge as an educator, however they're grouped. I actually think this model of distributing them actually, in many ways, as long as I'm owning that challenge, can make that work a little bit easier. I mean, it's never easy, but I mean, the challenge is making sure all those kids get to the point that we want them to get to. And that's really similar. I mean, it's kind of ironic that in order to have good groups, you need to have your kids really identified, which is what you've said, so that you're able to distribute them so that there's not an overly dense mass of kids in one area, because that's hard. Yeah.
You had a long day, and you have an early morning. Is there anything else from the committee on this presentation, Mr.
Sorry,
Brown?
Thank you very much for staying late. The only other points I had was consider the teacher's level of experience, expertise, and where, as well as the students and the guidance matching process would be one thought. And the other is just develop feedback loops that are scalable for this kind of thing, so that if either on the student or the teacher side, if there are frustrations, that we don't let those build too long before we address them.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
Anything else?
Thank you.
Oh. Motion to adjourn.
Oh,
no.
Not yet.
That was too quick.
One.
Dr. Doherty.
I have two calendar items.
And I have a calendar item if you don't hit it first.
One. Okay. So the March 20th meeting, there is not any urgent topics that need to be addressed.
Yep.
So I would propose to the committee that we not meet.
Yes, because we're meeting on the 15th and the 22nd.
Dr. Doherty and I had this conversation earlier today, given the frequency of FinCom meetings coming up and town meeting coming up. If we can combine a meeting, I think that makes sense.
Oh, that'd be wonderful.
So Mrs. Webb is supportive.
Yeah.
So you're saying to not have a school committee meeting on March 20th?
Correct.
Our next regularly scheduled meeting will be April 3rd.
Correct. And while we're on that April 3rd, so Carolyn is going to do a special education update. REF is going to present their grant awardees. You're going to vote, hopefully, on the last day of school.
Yay.
Gail is doing a quarterly budget update, and we will also have a personnel quarterly update.
That says April 25th on this.
We're going to move the personnel.
And the but not the district goals?
No.
Just the personnel. Do you want to do communication on website on the 3rd?
No, we're going to move communication out to the 4th. The 8th of May.
Got it. All right. Anybody on the committee have concerns with that?
Not with that.
Not with that?
I just have questions about agenda items.
Okay.
I'd like to... I'm wondering when we're going to work on, I think it might be under communication, but the brochure that we were working
Let's
on.
Let's add that to May 8th.
And also the discussion of the human rights resolution, presuming that we will have the council.
Yeah, I think we need to get some legal approval on that.
Okay, can we put it, though, on the docket so that when we have that, it will happen, please?
Sure. Mr. Bobbin.
And then maybe for, I don't know if it's made, we could probably just do this, Dr. Doherty, with the superintendent's update, but we have in April, you know, Passover, Easter, Good Friday, the number of holidays coming up that I think relate to a conversation we had, was it last year? It was quite a while ago, about the calendar. We talked about, this is not about changing any policies. This is just about you reporting out maybe April 3rd, if we're having a meeting then, if that's available.
There's a lot on the agenda already.
April 3rd's pretty
Well, it's just a superintendent update. It's not anything other than,
is how I'll give to you the memo that I'm going to be sending out and what we're doing.
I just want to make sure, and the reason I raise it is just that we had a number of parents show up to talk about their experience in the fall, and so I just want to address those comments before, you know, we have more holidays that would fit the same concern that they had raised, and make sure that they understand the measures we're taking to address their concerns.
Anything else on the calendar? Mrs. Webb?
I see that we have the superintendent's evaluation on May 22nd. Is that the, that, is that supposed to be the final?
No.
That's the beginning.
Yes.
That's the start. Okay, so, okay, maybe, I just want to make sure we have a good plan and that we don't let that slip.
Yes, I agree with you completely. That, let's just make that a commitment among the six of us. But I do totally agree with you. Mm-hmm. Anything else on the calendar?
I was just wondering on, it relates to the calendar, it's not about a date, the subcommittee that was going to discuss the accommodation policy on the same ideas.
Let's, you and I can loop back on that.
My recommendation is that that's something that we work on during the summer.
Well, certainly not before town meeting.
Yeah, but that's why I'm saying it's a policy that, and as a, you know, what I was asked to do was put together a group of teachers and parents.
Yep.
To make suggested changes that the school committee would look at.
Mm-hmm.
Given everything that we talked about at the last meeting,
yeah.
This isn't something right now that we can put on our plate.
Yep, I agree with you. I agree with you with the town meeting coming up.
Okay. And I'll volunteer as a parent in any case to be part of that if that's helpful,
right.
if it's helpful.
Thank you.
And that would have contractual potentially implications too if we start.
No, I don't think it would have any, it's the accommodations.
It's definitely not looking at calendar, only looking
yeah.
at the accommodations.
Yeah, it's not the calendar piece, it's the accommodations policy
the
piece.
Process, really. What we ask teachers to do or not do and
anything else?
Nope. Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. I put the motion.
Good night.